Good morning and welcome to the 30th meeting in 2022 of the Economy and Fair Work Committee. Our first item of business is a decision to take items 3 and 4 in private. Are members content? Thank you. So our next item of business is an evidence session on Scotland's economic outlook. The purpose of today's session is to consider the key economic trends facing our economy and to look towards the challenges of 2023. We will have further sessions on this before the end of the year. I welcome Professor Jajit Jadha, who is Director of National Institute of Economic and Social Research, who's joined by Emma Congreve, Deputy Director, Fraser Valander Institute, and Susan Murray, Director of the David Hume Institute. And as always, if members and witnesses can keep their questions and answers as concise as possible, we will get through a lot of questions in business this morning. Could I start maybe by asking the witnesses about inflation? And we have had news this morning that inflation has slightly dropped on where it was last month. We, as a committee, took evidence from the hospitality sector a few weeks ago that inflation rates having a huge impact on many areas of the economy, in particular hospitality. And while we see this slight decrease, it's anticipated that next year we'll see a decrease come down to about 7%. But when will this have a positive impact on businesses? Is it likely to start to make those sectors that are under huge cross pressures more affordable? And when is that likely to happen? If I'm going to go to Professor Jadha, first of all, to give an overview of the situation at a UK level, that would be helpful.
Well, thank you very much, Chair, and thank you very much for inviting me to give evidence this morning. I apologise for not being able to be there in person, but the transport problems currently facing the UK have been beyond us to arrange this morning, and thank you for allowing me to give evidence online. The inflation shock we're suffering is extremely unusual given the backdrop of the last 25 years. The average inflation rate since May 1997 up till the early part of this year was indeed around 2%. The people are experiencing inflation levels that they're not expecting or able necessarily to understand. So an important part of the process for the last few months is explaining what the causes of this large increase in inflation are. And they're very much associated with the increase in gas and energy and food prices directly caused by the Russian invasion of Ukraine that's elevated prices in international markets, which are set in dollars, against an exchange rate. As you know, the sterling has been rather volatile this year. And that has led to a large escalation in domestic prices and generated inflation in double digits. We don't think that's going to come down to something associated with normal levels of around 2% for a couple of years yet. But we're looking at something like 2024, 2025, which means that throughout the course of next year, inflation will be very high by what we now consider to be normal standards. And as you said, that will place pressure on many households and many industries in terms of containing their costs and also thinking about where they set their final costs for consumers who are also in the bottom part of the distribution suffering from the cost of living crisis. These are very difficult and precarious times.
And Emma Congreve, would you maybe like to come in on Fraser Valander's work around the impact on the Scottish economy and, you know, where you see or how pressures can be relieved on the sectors that I've referred to already, hospitality in particular?
Of course. So we're facing obviously the same pressures that are facing the rest of the UK. So there's nothing different in that sense in terms of the key drivers of inflation. I suppose what we are thinking about in terms of how that affects the economy, it's what is in place in order to mitigate some of the impacts of that high inflation, which is out with the control. The drivers of inflation are out with the control of UK and Scottish governments. So a key thing that we're looking for in a new year for both businesses and consumers, but appreciate businesses is the key question here, is around what will happen to the support for energy costs April. So as yet, we do not know what that will be. And that's a huge concern for businesses and particularly in the hospitality sector, because they are going to be facing a very difficult winter in terms of making decisions about whether they're able to keep open through that period. And of course, they will be thinking ahead as to what happens after that. So I think that's the key unknown at the moment, really, in terms of that outlook and how it will affect businesses is what support may or may not come through for energy costs come April.
Thank you, Emma. And we'll just come to Susan. So if I would change direction a wee bit, Susan, in terms of employment, and it's what the impact of inflation is having on employment. Because at the moment, I think there's figures out today saying that Scotland has the, you know, we're at really high employment. And I think I've still seen figures today saying that women's employment is higher than it's been for quite a long time. So it's a really buoyant labour market, but it's also a really tight labour market. But looking at the papers, there was also suggestions that unemployment is starting to creep up. Could you maybe explain, because there are concerns that, you know, as the labour market is so tight, but businesses are under so many cost pressures that even in a kind of areas where it's quite buoyant, they will start to contract because of the other pressures in the economy, which could actually lead us to a situation of employment. Can you do some forecasting around what we can expect to see next year in terms of employment?
Thanks. Yes, so there's lots of different forecasts out there, depending on who you speak to. But the general consensus is that people are a bit scared about what might be coming down the line. So we've done more work with the actual sort of labour market and the workforce than we have with businesses. But businesses are kind of, they know they've got a labour need there at the moment. So in terms of recruitment, but they're not necessarily sure that they want to recruit because they're worried about a recession coming next year. So when you look at the predictions of people cutting back on spending, there are on everything that we track in the Understanding Scotland survey, everything that people might spend money on that most people are planning to spend to cut back on. And 9 out of 10 Scots believe that general economic conditions are going to get worse next year. But the thing that worries me most, I think, in terms of the labour market, is that 1 in 4 people are losing sleep over their finances. And so if you take that in terms of the labour market, your labour force becomes less productive if people are losing sleep. And so if we think about how businesses stay profitable and continue to thrive, if you've got large numbers of your workforce losing sleep, and the figure rises with parents, it rises to 35% of people with children. If you've got people more anxious and losing sleep over their finances, then you're going to have less thriving businesses.
Thank you. And just the final question, if I go back to Professor Chadha, Professor, do you have any comments or reflections on employment and where we might be next year in terms of employment levels?
Thank you very much. Very interesting to hear Emma just now. Our own analysis, as we do a devolved nation analysis every quarter, as well as the UK analysis, and actually I hear very much the concerns that households have about finances, increasing mortgage costs and food costs. But in terms of employment growth, Scotland does pretty well relative to the rest of the UK, about a percent growth in employment higher than the rest of the country. There is relatively high levels of productivity in Scotland compared to the rest of the country if you take out London and the South East. And as a result, it just, in terms of employment growth, looks more resilient than we might have anticipated. So there is some good news in the middle of all that bad news there, that employment growth looks reasonably robust in Scotland, partly kicked off last year by COP26, but that seems to continue over our forecast horizon. For example, we don't expect positive employment growth in the whole of the UK until the end of 2022, but across our forecast period of 2022, 2023, 2024, we see positive employment growth for Scotland.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm going to bring in Graham Simpson to be followed by Fiona Hislop.
Thanks very much, convener. I think I'll start with, I'm going to ask another question about inflation, and I'll start again with you, Professor Chadha. And first of all, just congratulate you for managing to get the word hipster into a report that you wrote fairly recently. So well done for that. On inflation, I noticed the Bank of England published its monetary policy report recently, and it was predicting that inflation could fall to 1.5% 4% by the end of 2024, which is quite a dramatic drop. So I just wonder, you know, what do you think that's based on, and do you think there's any prospect of that actually happening?
Well, where inflation goes is absolutely a function of where bank rate goes, and the bank itself was clear that there are a number of scenarios for bank rate, one which would be where bank rate rises in line with market expectations, which, as you'll recall, last month were fairly broiled as a result of the mini budget, which we may want to come to a little bit later on. And those expectations where bank rate might rise to 5% or more and stay there had some advantage of leading to a faster fall in inflation, but also at the same time, a deeper and more prolonged recession as demand, which is particularly sensitive to rapid increases in interest rates, kept at a high level for a long time, falling more quickly than the bank ideally would have wanted. I think the overall sense from the bank is that actually inflation, which is the change in prices, will start to move out of the window of comparison. That the large increase in prices were at the turn or the early part of this year. And as we move forward over time, that 12-month window of comparison will disappear. And as a result of that, inflation will start to come down. And the danger is that if we raise interest rates too much, the core level of demand in the economy will fall too quickly. That will lead to inflation falling too quickly as well. So I think overall, there is the prospect of inflation coming back in line with price stability by about 2024, which I think is not inconsistent with something around 2% at the end of 2023. But we wouldn't want to see that happen too quickly, because that itself would suggest that we'd had a deeper recession with more unemployment than we ideally would want as a society.
Okay, that's fair enough. So although inflation is the issue, the big issue, what you're saying is we actually need some of it, some inflation. We don't need to, we don't want to choke off inflation altogether, because that could have harmful effects.
That's right. We don't want to bring down what is an inflation caused by external factors too rapidly, because that would imply a deeper and longer recession than would otherwise be the case. A lot of the inflation that we see will essentially work its way out of the system as the one-off increase in prices moves out of the frame of comparison, which will happen as we move across next year. That said, there is some possibility of what economists call second round effects, where people who are setting wages and prices, we've just talked about that with hospitality, start to factor in higher inflation expectations into their processes. And that means inflation will stay a little bit higher for longer. And that's essentially why the Bank of England has to raise interest rates, to sort of say, well, we are targeting inflation of 2% a couple of years down the line, and we'll set bank rate accordingly. I think that is still the most likely scenario, that we'll get there in about a year and a bit, rather than in the next few months.
Okay, so if I can widen it for the other two witnesses and ask, how confident are you that the economy generally can recover over the next year to 18 months, say? And if we maybe start with Susan and then Emma. I mean, can you give us any Christmas cheer? Because everyone seems a bit gloomy at the moment.
I'm not sure I can. I think I feel a bit like the people answering the Understanding Scotland survey, in that I'm a bit nervous about what's coming down the line. And I think that's because in recent years we've had several... The term that we hear a lot is unprecedented shocks, but we know we're moving into a period of a bit more global instability than we've had before. And I think you can look at all the variables we've got now and think, well, we might be okay in a year to a year and a half, but what if something else comes? And I think that's what makes me worried at the moment. And I think that's coming through in lots of surveys we see. So it's, how do you build back confidence that people feel a bit more resilient if there is another shock down the line? And we can't guess what those shocks might be. I mean, we saw a few years ago, an eruption era in Iceland threw everything off for a good few months. And so I think that the bigger question is how do we make Scotland and the people in Scotland more resilient to cope with whatever is thrown at us in future?
Okay, and Emma?
So, maybe not too much in the way of Christmas cheer, but we have seen, you know, what we've been through over the past few years in terms of the amount of shocks we've had to the economy have been considerable. And a lot of the reason why the economy, well, particularly the labour market, has been a bit more resilient than we maybe would have expected has been there has been some quite effective government policy coming down the line from the UK government mainly, but also the Scottish government playing its role too. So part of the you know, what we're hoping for in terms of Christmas cheer is that policy will do what it needs to do to mitigate the impact of the worst of the of inflation in terms of energy costs, and will provide the right kind of support to households and businesses in to get over this hump in the next couple of years. And I think when we had the autumn statement and the forecast from the OBR, they did they were a little bit more optimistic than the Bank of England, who came, you know, a couple of weeks before, partly in recognition of some of the measures that were in the autumn statement that are putting a bit more money into the system to try and keep the economy, but to ensure that the recession is as shallow as possible. So I guess that's, you know, it's good news. There are things that the government can do to help with this. But as I said in my earlier question, there is a bit of a gap in terms of, you know, knowing what those decisions are going to be. And the fact we've had so many changes of policy and, you know, I think businesses and people at home are kind of, they are uncertain because they're not, there's reasons to not be sure whether the government's going to do the right thing, but hopefully they will. So.
You can have one more question, and I think Professor Chadha would like to come in on this as well, if you want to invite him.
Oh, okay. So maybe he can answer this when he comes in.
Yes.
I was just wondering, we've got a statement from John Swinney tomorrow. If you were speaking to him today, what's the one thing you would ask him to announce tomorrow?
It's not. I wouldn't like to ask a political leader to make any announcement, but I think I would go back to the point I made some moments ago. The one important development in the British labour market over the last couple of decades is that employment rates have continued to be high. So after the financial crisis, and even during the what has been anemic economic growth in the last 12 years, with the Brexit process, let's call it that, COVID and the war, employment has remained high and stable, and unemployment rates are below what we normally think we'd expect to see in an economy of, say, 4 to 5%, or unemployment rates are below that. But the one thing I think that concerns us and might help the economy more is to think about inactivity rates. Why is it that older people have left the workforce? I think there's some good reasons there. It's concerns about COVID, concerns of, about interacting, but also many younger people also around the country seem to have left the labour force through long-term illness. And I would like to think about how can we address that? Because if we can get people back into work, work is much more important than just the income you get, the social interactions, the learning by doing, the connection with society. All of these things are so important in the world of work, and to see that inactivity rates across the country may be increasing is something I would like our political leaders to think a little bit harder about.
Okay, thank you. Just before bringing Fiona Hislop, can I just ask Professor Chadha? So yeah, we do have high employment, but we also know that there's quite a lot of people in low wage employment that are actually living on the breadline, that are requiring greater support from government. Is that more the employment? Because it always sounds really positive when we have high employment rates, and it is, but there is a significant amount of people who aren't really earning enough money to keep their families and keep their mortgages and put food on the table. How do we, you know, what kind of changes do we need to see in the economy? That's a huge question, but...
Well, if I may, I'll just answer very briefly. Of course, you're absolutely right. We've been... Sure, am I online now? I'm not sure. Someone just tell me. Can you hear me?
Yes.
You can, sorry. Yes. It's just a slight glitch in front of me. Forgive me for that. You're absolutely right. We've been terribly concerned about the increase in destitution across the country, with people with a much larger fraction of people in lower income brackets, despite this increase in employment. The cost of living crisis is amplified for those households because they tend to spend a much larger fraction of their disposable income on food and energy. So there is absolutely a need to provide support for them. We're seeing worrying increases in access to food banks. And if we move a little bit further up the income distribution for those people with mortgages, there is a concern as well that higher interest rates may leave some families unable to meet their interest payments, or indeed if they're renting, as rent start to go up. So we certainly need some more level of support there. But as a long run, in terms of getting those real wages up, the national living wage has helped, certainly, but that's not what we want to aim for. That's not the best. That's okay. But to really raise wages in the longer run, we need to think about productivity and how it can be that the return from an hour of work leads to more output than it is than we currently see in a large fraction of industries across the country. And that, you know, is a deep, deep problem facing the UK economy, and it's a lack of infrastructure, a lack of skills, connectivity at the broadband level, and underpinning it. We've learned from the COVID crisis as well, it's really important that our health care, social care and education services are also supported in a way that perhaps they haven't been in the last 12 or so years. And all of these things, I think, lead to a lower level of productivity and a lower level of real wages for households in the lower parts of the distribution. That said, for people lucky enough to have high levels of education or human capital and with the appropriate networks, wages at the top end of the distribution have done exceptionally well. But I think that level of inequality is a severe problem facing society, and one that has to be addressed. We can't address it tomorrow, but it's very important that we discuss it and think about appropriate policies that are consistent with the narrative I've just outlined and address them.
Thank you. I'm going to bring in Fiona Hislop to be followed by Maggie Chapman.
Thank you all for joining us this morning. I'd like to ask the same question to all of you, but I'll start with Emma Congreve first, if that's okay. I'd like to ask you your view on, is Brexit baked in already into UK and Scottish economic performance, or do you expect it to have a continuing and latent impact? And if so, what do you think that will be? So Emma first, please.
Thanks. part of the problem we have is when Brexit finally occurred, we were in the depths of the pandemic. So it has been really difficult to separate the impact of Brexit from what was happening in the economy anyway. So that's the first caveat, I'm afraid. But we'll often get challenged on this by people, you know, people have very different views on this. And because the evidence isn't clear, it is really difficult to say with a lot of certainty, but it's very difficult to see a scenario in which Brexit has not had an impact in terms of the frictions it's introduced into trade, the restrictions on the freedom of movement, and potentially that's been exacerbated by COVID because people living elsewhere in Europe may have gone home during the pandemic and then couldn't come back as they would have done otherwise had Brexit not occurred. And all of those, I would expect, will be feeding into inflation and into GDP. Whether or not that is already baked in, I think a lot of it will be in the system now and is part of the issues that we're facing at the moment. So in some ways it's a shock that happens, but it has an ongoing legacy, and it means that things that we, as I say, were taken for granted before, free movement of labour, very flexible supply chains, things being able to kind of move without those frictions, they will continue to be an issue for people, and it will just take quite a long time for the economy to adjust to the sort of the new normal. But because of the issues we've been through in the last few years, as I say, it is quite difficult to separate these facts out, which I know is frustrating because we don't have that that black and white answer. But I think that's where our work at the Institute has got us to do in terms of what we think the impact is. But going forward, it may be possible to do some more comparative analysis with other countries in Europe, you know, once we have a bit more outturn data to actually try and disentangle some of these things.
I'm very conscious it's a big question, so perhaps if I come to Susan next, I mean, please feel free to just do a top-line summary if that's helpful. Susan, please.
Thanks. I think Emma summarised it really well, and I'm mindful of time, so I won't add anything more. I think it in terms of is it baked in, I think it's too early to tell. Yes, we're seeing some effects, but I think my top-line summary.
And Professor Chadha? And the same question.
Thank you very much. Great question, if I may say. The overall view about what the Brexit process we've gone through, because don't forget we had a number of years of uncertainty that also held back many investment and FDI plans as well before Brexit was announced, because there was the sense of what would actually happen in the way it would happen. We have a form of Brexit. It doesn't look like it will be the final set of relations we have with the European Union, or indeed we haven't yet established the trade agreements with the other parts of the world in the way that it was said it could be done much more quickly than it has turned out to be the case. And that continues to inject uncertainty in our trading relations, not only in terms of manufactured goods and services, but also capital allocation as well around the world. And that, I think, is continuing to act as a drag on our economic performance. At the National Institute and other places, we think the overall impact of the Brexit process we've had on GDP, a measure of output, is some 4 to 6%. But just to go back to a point raised by Emma a minute ago, Brexit itself is interacting with the next set of shocks to make them worse than they would otherwise be. Labour hasn't returned after COVID. The shocks that we're seeing from food and energy have been exacerbated on domestic inflation and exacerbated the negative impact on GDP because of the Brexit process, so that even though it's happened, it continues to interact with the shocks that come along to make them worse than they would otherwise would be the case. But so it's not been, so far, a great story for the UK economy.
And can I stay with Professor Chadha? And I want to address the issue of investment. Each economic crisis can be different. After the financial crash, the Scottish Government embarked on our construction-led investment recovery. In 2010, it was estimated about a third of all construction in the UK at that time was in Scotland, underpinned by the Queensbury Crossing Rail, etc. But clearly, in inflation and indeed other aspects have will affect the ability, and you talked about it already, about capital investment for people to businesses to invest. And I'm interested in your take as to where we are currently in terms of investment, business investment, and in particular looking at the recent UK Chancellor's budget statement, what the impacts of that will be on business investment, and for the Scottish economy in particular. Renewables is very important to us, as it is to the rest of the UK economy, but particularly in Scotland. What impact will the measures in the UK Chancellor's statement have on investment for recovery? And do you think that is, for this crisis, a route forward, or because of inflation, is that kind of constrained? So Professor Chadha first, and if we have time, I'd be interested in the other's perspective.
Well, if I may, I'll keep my answer brief and certainly give Susan and Emma time to answer. Level of business investment following 2016 looks like it's somewhere in the order of 15 to 20% below where we would have anticipated it, looking at the previous trend. So, businesses have clearly deferred investment plans as a result of the uncertainty over Brexit and the trade relations, as well as the economic and political uncertainty that we've faced in the last few years. So that itself is a major cause of our worse economic prospects than we are. I might otherwise have anticipated. That's something that very much needs to be addressed. At the same time, public investment has, to some extent in the last couple of years, improved, but it hasn't yet offset the long-run secular decline in public investment. Public investment in the UK in the last 4 years has averaged around 1.5% of GDP. It should be around 3% of GDP. And as you were hinting with the autumn statement, even though there are plans to continue the nominal amount of public expenditure, the inflation shocks will mean over the course of the planning horizon that public investment will fall once again far below that 3% of GDP level. And that, in the longer run, is also problematic. It's not only because public investment itself helps the economy, but I think it interacts and provides support for businesses and private investment. These are not separate things. Sometimes they're treated as, if we have more public investment, that means taxes will go up and businesses won't invest. I don't really think that's the right way to think about it. The two interact in a positive manner. There are positive spillovers from the right form of directed public investment of the type you described in Scotland that provides confidence for business investment. And I don't think we're there yet. There's an attempt to unlock the financial sector to provide more investment, but it's a concern that we're not entirely sure where that will end up. There's a tendency of the financial sector to look towards London and the South East. Will that help with levelling up or the economic prospects of the devolved nations? It's not entirely clear because we're not sure that we have a financial sector that looks after the whole of the country rather than just London and the South East. I think that's a question to be asking policymakers in Westminster. And finally, FDI, foreign direct investment, has not done particularly well in the last couple of years earlier. It's very lumpy. So just a small number of changes can lead to a large change in the actual pattern of FDI. But it's something I think that has been affected by all the things that we've been talking about. But again, it may be something that the government in Scotland may be able to reach out to people overseas to invest directly in the country. And that would be an important avenue potentially for the Scottish economy.
Thank you. I'm going to come to Susan Murray if you want to maybe comment on where you see business investment as a result of the UK Chancellor's statement and indeed what you might expect or want to see from the budget from Scotland to help business and investment and potentially the impact of public investment on that private business aspect as well.
Thanks. I think I'm really struck by the recent call at the Scottish Chamber of Commerce annual dinner from was it Liz Cameron that encouraged everyone to have confidence and invest. And I think so much of business investment is actually around what people think is coming down the line. You know, so are they confident that we're going to go through a quick recession and is now the time to invest so that they're stronger and more ready to take advantage when we come out the other side of higher inflation. And I think I'm really, really struck with how that links with the general population, because business owners are also people that are seeing the effects on their own lives. And I think we shouldn't ever underestimate that kind of circle. I think one of the questions before links with this in that, what do we want to see in the coming budget? I think businesses and in order to attract foreign direct investment, we need to stick the course with the things we've said we're going to do. So particularly, you know, the targets to reduce child poverty, you know, we know this is going to be really challenging times to do that. But we also know that that's a really good thing for the economy to do, because we end up with a better equipped workforce. We end up with parents more able to support their children and their children to go on into work. And I think those long term commitments we've made on child poverty and on climate change have got to still be part of the plan, even though we've got these immediate crises going on. And I think that is the really difficult juggling act that when you've got a constrained spending envelope, it's going to be tricky to do, but that's going to be what investors want to see.
And then finally to Emma Congreve, if you can address the views on business investment and particularly maybe around renewables. Certainly that certainty and pipeline encourages people to invest, but clearly some of the issues around the UK Chancellor's statement may have an impact on that. I'd be interested in views whether you think it will or not. And clearly that's an implication for the Scottish Government in terms of its certainty, in terms of where businesses can invest, particularly to deliver renewable energy and deliver net zero.
Yeah, I mean, you're absolutely right that that industry is the renewable industry, and the growth over the past decade or so is an example of where a certainty of government policy over a long time horizon has led to investment. And I think that's a really, you know, that's an important point. Again, government policy can be effective, but where there's uncertainty about what's coming and what may or may not be the next decision or U-turn or whatever, that puts businesses in a very difficult position. So I can't talk too specifically about renewables. It's just not the area of my expertise, but certainly we've done a lot of work with hospitality businesses and asking, working with them to understand what their kind of the big barriers are to them having certainty over the future in terms of their investment. And actually the top two things that came out for the next decade is uncertainty over security of energy. So again, that comes back to both what's going on now, but also the need for that long-term investment to ensure as much as possible there can be more uncertainty going forward. But also for them, it was the effectiveness or otherwise of government policy on policies directed towards their sector. And again, needing to feel more confident that the right things were being done by the industry. And I should mention that one of the things that came up in terms of not giving certainty is the bottle return scheme that's coming in next year, and really they're not feeling it's not being thought through the implications it will have on their businesses, and again, so there's a lot of conflicts in there between policies on net zero and day-to-day business. Just one point that I would make about tomorrow is that we should be getting some decisions on non-domestic rates. We are going through a rates revaluation at the moment, which comes into force in April 2023. And that's a huge concern for businesses. They do now know what their rateable values will be for the year ahead. But we'll be waiting tomorrow to see what the decisions are being made on poundage and indeed the reliefs, any more reliefs that are coming through the system. And there was some announced in the autumn statement for the rest of the UK that may come through into the Scottish policy. But that's a really important part of a business's bottom line. So certainty and good evidence-based policy on the reliefs that are in that system will be really important.
Thank you very much, Convener.
Thank you.
I'm going to change the order and bring Gordon MacDonald in, but Michelle Thompson, did you want a supplementary? Could it be directed to one of the panellists, please? Is that possible?
Yeah, I think it would be to Professor Chadha. It was just picking up on the point of Brexit. I'm on the Finance Committee in the Scottish Parliament. We had the OBR in yesterday, who, of course, commented on Brexit in their Economic and Fiscal Outlook report of November 2022, basically saying it had a significant adverse impact, and quoting various stats about trade volumes falling 8.3% below the present in quarter four 2023. But an interesting comment they made was about trade intensity being 15% lower than if the UK had remained in the EU. In other words, trade intensity, a measure of country indication with the world economy. So I asked what their outlook was for that to continue. And their comment was they anticipated that to continue for at least another 15 years. This is despite the trade deals that have been done. So I just wanted to ask, were you aware of that? And have you got any further reflections then in terms of outlook in the light of their comments yesterday? Thank you.
Thank you very much. I mean, it's clear that the Brexit process has reduced trade intensity with this huge economic bloc across the channel. And it's difficult to see right now why that wouldn't stay at the lower levels that we now see for quite some time to come. So as a starting point for assumption, that the OBR's view is probably about right. I am, though, hopeful that over time we may reverse some of that fall in trade intensity as we collectively come out and recover from COVID and the oil, gas, energy price shocks and food price shocks we're currently absorbing. So I see that as a central case being quite sensible, but I see there are positive risks on the upside from that, if you see what I mean, the world in which it might well be better than we're envisaging. But for planning purposes, I would very much agree with the OPL's view.
Gordon MacDonald, be followed by Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, Convener. And I want to address my questions to start with Professor Chadha. We've talked about the labour situation, and I want to come back to you on a couple of things and what you said earlier on. You quite rightly highlighted that employment remains high, and Scotland's certainly at record employment levels at the moment. Unemployment rate is lower than what it is in the UK, and inactivity rate is lower than what it is in the UK. So could you say something about the record vacancy levels that are in the economy? I don't have a Scotland number, but I know that across the UK it's about 1.2 million, and what impact that's having on the economy and how we address it.
Thank you. The vacancy levels are very much driven by both the inactivity issues that we've talked about with people withdrawing from the labour force following COVID, as well as what was said earlier, a tendency for people who had jobs in hospitality, recreation, other areas, often from overseas, not returning after the COVID period, meaning there are gaps. Now, over the longer run, one can hope that particularly education, further education colleges, could be deployed in order to train people to work in the areas which seem to be short. But in the short run, not a lot, it seems to me, can be done other than consider the wages being offered that might provide more of an incentive to close some of the vacancy gaps. It is a major concern that we have vacancies at the same time that we have inactivity rates rising. I think the balance of that would be to put some upward pressure on real wages, and that's no bad thing if that can help alleviate some of the cost of living crisis. A large number of the vacancies are in the lower income or wage areas or industries in which wages have historically been low. That might be addressed as a result of that.
You've touched a couple of times about inactivity rates. I don't know if you have the Scotland numbers, but certainly I like looking at the long-term trends. And in May 2007, which was, you know, long number of years ago, the inactivity rate in Scotland was 21.4. The recent inactivity levels for October 2022 is 21.4. So the exact same percentage as it was 14 years ago or 15 years ago. Has there been change in the inactivity levels, given that currently 87% of those inactive are students or family commitments or long-term sick or retired? Has that changed from the situation in 2007 where it was the exact same percentage of the employment rate?
So you're asking about the composition of inactivity. I guess my comments just now were focused on the changes we've seen since the COVID cloud started to lift. So I'd be interested to I don't know off the top of my head what the inactivity rates were say the late part of the last decade, 2018-19, but my guess is that they were lower than we're now currently seeing. So the most recent trend is for that inactivity to increase. And you're quite right to say that it's in the areas of students and long-term people who've been unwell over a long-term basis, as well as older people leaving the workforce. It's still, I think, a little bit early after the COVID crisis for us to say that those people won't return to activity. My guess is that once we get past the winter and we go into the spring, people will reassess their prospects and we may well see people entering the labour force again, particularly as the cost of living crisis continues to hit over the course of next year. So it's a great fact to hear that we're at the same level of inactivity level in Scotland as we were some 15 years ago. But again, my guess is that that will start to fall as we proceed over the course of next year.
Thanks very much. And Emma, can you tell me what the links are between growing population and productivity?
Thanks. Well, there are three kind of main drivers of that link to the labour market and to economic growth. So population is one of those, participation the other, which you've just touched on, and productivity the other. So they are interrelated, but they are also drivers in themselves. So I think in terms of productivity, that's very much in terms of how the people that we have in the labour market at the moment are able to perform their work, and there are various reasons that come into that. I mean, I think one that I would, I think you're right to talk about is inactivity and the driver of that in terms of long-term health. So not only does that have an impact on participation, it also has an impact on productivity in the workplace, which Susan touched on earlier. And, you know, we are starting to make those links between the stats we see in terms of issues in the health sector, in terms of long waiting lists and potentially, you know, people living with chronic pain and ill health for a longer time than would have otherwise been the case, and the impact that has on their productivity in the workplace, as well as their ability to work in the first place, and also the pressures on the social care system and the impacts of people needing to do more unpaid care as a result of the care system not being able to pick up all the need that is there. And so I'm probably not answering maybe exactly what you wanted to hear, but productivity and population interrelated, but in they are also sort of their own drivers in themselves.
The reason for asking the question is, we may well be able to increase employment from folk that are inactive, but that's not going to fill all of the vacancies that are available to us. And we're sitting next to Europe, where the unemployment level is at 6%. We've got Spain at 12.5%, Greece at 11.5%, and France at 7%, where there's a readily available workforce that previously came to the UK and Scotland to fill vacancies in hospitality, etc., where we know we've got a problem. And I'm just wondering what you think is the impact of the loss of freedom of movement on the economy.
Well, I mean, I think it is as you kind of laid out, it is the fact that we have record vacancies and we have not got the ability for that flexibility of people to move across borders in the way that they were before. Now, this is it's a big shock to the economy, a big shock to those sectors that relied on that labour, but they will adjust over the long term. You know, they will have to. It may lead to some businesses no longer being viable, absolutely. And I think rural areas are particularly vulnerable to that, and because they require people to relocate and need to provide housing in order for them to be able to afford to live in the area. So there are a lot of factors going on there. But certainly, yeah, that's part of the story here. But you know, it's not the only issue that's driving vacancies, but it is a big part of the story.
Thank you. And Susan, I wanted to ask you about the number of registered businesses in Scotland and how important that is for growing the economy and providing new jobs. Looking back at the time series for the number of registered businesses in Scotland by all different sizes, 2006 it was 147,000. In 2022, there was 175,000, which is a growth of 19%. And similarly, for all businesses, both registered and unregistered, that's grown from 267,000 to 360,000 in 2022. So if we've got this contraction in labour, what impact is that going to have on the growth of companies in Scotland and GDP, for that matter?
I think that's a really interesting question. I think what's hidden in that the numbers that you've quoted are also other trends. So the number of those businesses that are
only employing a single person, so director-led companies, and has a massive skew on those numbers. And I think we've seen that particularly over the last 10 years. So if you took out those from the trends and then looked at those numbers again with the number of those businesses that then employ other people, I think you see a different pattern. I can't remember it off the top of my head. You don't? Okay. If we've got a contracting labour market, then we're gonna have a problem. Emma's already kind of covered that, and I know we're short of time, so I won't go into that too much then.
Right. Okay. Just to be clear, every single category of employer has shown an increase since 2006.
Okay. Thanks.
Thanks very much.
Okay. Thank you. I'm now going to bring in Maggie Chapman to be followed by Jamie Harkle-Johnson.
Thanks very much, Ken, and good morning to the panel. Thank you for joining us this morning, and thanks for your comments so far and the materials that your organisations have provided. I want to follow on actually from some of Gordon MacDonald's questions around the interaction between the economic outlook, the budget discussions that we'll have tomorrow, and the broader recovery that Professor Jada, you've talked about, and others too, that the consequences from COVID, Brexit, and the like in the current economic climate. Emma, if I can come to you first, in your budget report that Fraser Vallander Institute published, I think just this week, there's a very, very stark comment around social security and the consequences of some of the labour trends that we've been talking about and the increased reliance on social security. We know that social security spend is going up for significant policy and other reasons. But I'm wondering whether you could say a little bit more about how you see that interacting and potentially providing a more unstable or more volatile economy in the future if people aren't being able to get the social security support that they need, you know, even though the spend there is increasing.
Thank you. So, I mean, there are two main types of social security spends. So we've got the sort of the means-tested support, which largely is governed by UK government, although Scottish government with the Scottish Child Payment has moved into that area with its new powers. And then we have sort of the non-means tested, the disability and carer support, which is designed to cover additional costs of ill health. And so in terms of what's happening in Scotland in terms of social security, so we have seen from the plan set out in the spending review back in May, and you know it is quite stark in our report when you see it on the graph, the projected increase in social security spending. A lot of that is around the Scottish Child Payment. So because that's been sort of ramping up this year, both in terms of the amounts being paid, it's now up to £25 per week per eligible child, and it's also now open to all children under the rather than previously it was just limited to children under five, I think. So that's the key, that's what's happening there, and that's a big part of the increases. The other part is that there is and actually there may be some more shocks to this tomorrow, there is on the disability side there are signs, and this was in the OBR forecast, that there is an increased caseload coming through onto personal independence payment, which is the UK benefit. We're transitioning in Scotland to adult disability payment, but we still have the PIP caseload there, which has been kind of increasing this year in Scotland. So that's another reason. And some of that, I think, was in that May forecast, but there may be some more. So that's the kind of the mirror of what's happening in the labour market in terms of inactivity and ill health showing up in the social security statistics. I mean, in terms of whether all the needs are being met in terms of the social security system, I think there are concerns there, but mainly because of the years of austerity and the reductions that happened then, meaning that social security fell behind in terms of being able to sort of keep up the same standard of living for people. But we have seen in the autumn statement, the UK government has increased the uprating of those benefits in line with inflation. So they will increase by around 10% come April. And we expect the Scottish government to be doing the same with the benefits that they have responsibility for, apart from the Scottish Child Payment, because they've only just increased it. We're not sure whether we'll see a 10% increase in that come April compared to its current value. It's such an important part of the system, it is. At the moment, it seems to be sort of keeping up with things, but because of what's happened in the last 10 years, it probably is behind where we would like it to be in terms of, you know, giving equivalent support to what we would have hoped had we not had austerity.
No, thank you. And I suppose that the trends that we've seen over the last 10, 12 years since the financial crash maybe in part come back to one of the other points Gordon was making about that the different composition of employment of labour market inactivity and therefore the increased reliance on potentially social security. And I suppose I'm wondering whether you have any comments or any pointers for us around that focus on employment of people who have chosen or who have taken themselves out of the employment market for health reasons, for caring reasons, and whether we actually need to be focusing more on that in terms of getting more people, you know, single parents back into employment. You know, and this isn't about employability figures, because we know that the employment figures as they are high, but it's that untapped potential, I suppose, and that economically inactive group of people that probably want to work but can't for a whole range of other reasons, social security being one of them. And I'm wondering how we can tease that apart and make a connection in a way that's economically positive rather than an economic drain in the long term. Emma, I don't know if you've got any more to say, and then I'll come to Professor Chadha on this.
Yeah, I'll come in. As you say, there are many reasons why people who are inactive are inactive, and some of them do want to work. The whether or not it's the social security system themselves that is a barrier to that, I think there is evidence that that is the case for some people, particularly those on some of the disability benefits. And we think some of this is kind of this fear of once you've if you try to go back to work when you've been ill or that the fact you've tried to work, even if it doesn't work out for you and you have to come back, that there might be some implication there for all of the benefits, not just your means tested ones, but your additional cost benefits as well. There's a lot of fear and uncertainty in the system, but I think the Scottish Social Security system is really trying to address that and trying to give that assurance that it's there to support, not to try and hinder people in terms of their lives. So I think if you're looking at particularly parents, when we look at the statistics, so there are very few parents who, if we look at parents in couples, there are very few examples of where parents are not working, where in the case where there's not a disability or ill health issue present. And for single parents, it's a bit higher, but it's very much linked to the age of their child. And that very much links to the availability of childcare support, not just for preschool, but wraparound support out for school-aged children as well. So I think that's where the big barriers are. It's around treatments for long-term ill health, including mental health, and it's around removing barriers for parents. My kind of feeling from looking at a lot of data on this, there are some examples of this, but on the whole, it's not the social security system that's holding people back from re-engaging in the labour.
Yeah. No, thank you. I think I understand that. Professor Chadha, if I could bring you in on this, I think there is something interesting about the social security system not necessarily being a barrier, but actually our employment market and the labour market being the barrier. So not enabling flexible work, not enabling part-time work, not enabling, you know, shorter work weeks, those kinds of things. And I'm wondering what your comments are in the space, because I think we often talk about employment and the labour market separately to all the other support mechanisms around it. And I'm trying to make the connections here.
I'll just wait for a second for my mic to come up. This is an incredibly interesting discussion. The sense in which that support through Social Security alone might be providing a disincentive to work, and I don't think anyone in the discussion today is arguing that, is a very simplistic way to think about why people may not be participating in the workforce. Clearly, there are a number of barriers for people working outside of their direct receipt of Social Security payment. That's pointed a few. The cost of childcare in the UK is considerably higher than we see in many of our trading partners. That's something that is a great issue for people wanting to get back into the labour force after having started a family. And at the other end of the age spectrum, significant numbers of people later on in life are also caring for older parents or older family members, which also can reduce their incentive to work if the replacement costs are higher. That then asks some really important questions of our schools, our health and social care systems. Can they be redesigned to facilitate support at both ends of the spectrum in a way that's much easier for people who are of working age, however we want to define that? And clearly, as we hinted earlier on, we have a world in which those with higher levels of human capital can adapt to changing workplaces and continue to find employment. Now, of course, Scotland is a place with, relatively speaking, very high levels of human capital, but the world is always changing. And one thing we've learned from the COVID period is that, you know, we can supply education online, we can provide training and support services, and more of that ought to be available for people wanting to get back into work. And one could imagine a world of grants or subsidies or whatever it might be to encourage that. Many areas in higher education, further education, have developed ways of teaching online during COVID that could be redeployed to workforces now to help them train themselves. And firms ought to be participating in that as well. I think many firms are very positive to training employees or prospective employees, but somehow or other, we're still behind what we often see with many of our major trading partners in Germany or East Asia, where firms seem to want to participate in that process on a much more persistent basis. And then, of course, there are genuine hurdles to travel at the moment around the country, as my appearance online demonstrates. And that's hard for people if they're re-entering work and they have to commute. And train travel has become more expensive. So we've got this very strange world in which a significant fraction of people can work from home, but many in certain industries can't. And at the same time, I think all of these things are adding up to a set of rigidities that may not be helping higher levels of participation in the economy. I suppose it argues for thinking it through very carefully and deciding upon a set of policy measures that would just make it easier for people to get into work and stay in work. And as I've said, I've only listed a few here. I'm sure my colleagues have others they'd want to suggest. But you can see it needs a whole set of interventions and some robust thinking.
Okay, thank you. One last question, and it's on a different tack, if I may. And Emma, I'm coming back to you. The Fraser Rand published an article about the economic context for businesses in Scotland, and in that there's something that struck me, the difference between the impact of the broader economic situation on SMEs compared to larger businesses, turnover falling much more for SMEs than for larger businesses. And I'm just wondering what your analysis of the long-term consequences for local economies, for our regional economies, where quite often the SMEs are the bedrock of those economies, and how do we ensure that disproportionate negative impact on SMEs doesn't continue to drag? Because if it carries on in the same direction, you know, the economic situation of our local economies is just going to get worse and worse.
Thanks. It's not just being the bedrock of local economies. Actually, SMEs are the bedrock of the Scottish economy, really, when you look at it. So it's incredibly important, and it's really easy to understand why smaller businesses are struggling a bit more with some of the frictions that are going on, being able to less economies of scale, and particularly dealing with issues around trade at the moment. And also, we saw this in the financial crisis, and no doubt it's coming through again, issues with being able to refinance on good terms, with larger firms being able to go to the market, and smaller firms relying more on financing from the financial sector itself. So there are a lot of things in there. Of course, it goes without saying that given the number of businesses in Scotland that are domiciled in Scotland, that are SMEs, they're incredibly important to ensure that they are able to withstand what's going on. I come back to actually the point I made right at the beginning of it, is energy costs are just the most pressing issue that's coming through in our business monitor. So making sure that SMEs, particularly the hospitality sector, has that certainty of what's going to happen to their energy costs come April, so that they can plan for it at least. And that might mean that they have to reduce opening hours, but they have to be able to plan for it in order to be able to get through it. I think that's the key thing. And then the other issue, which is really pressing for SMEs, as I've also already mentioned, is non-domestic rates and the impact of revaluation and what will be happening to reliefs, particularly in the next wee while. It's worth mentioning that we do have the small business bonus scheme in Scotland, which does take a lot of businesses and smaller businesses out of non-domestic rates entirely, but it is felt that it's not necessarily always the most consistent approach or the right approach in order to be giving these reliefs purely based on the rateable value in non-domestic rate terms of those businesses. Hospitality, who are valued in a slightly different way than other premises, do feel that they're potentially a little bit disadvantaged by that system. The revaluation of NDR is necessary, but there's probably other reforms within that system to ensure that it's actually getting the most support out to those who really need it, which something like the business bonus scheme probably isn't quite doing at the moment.
Really helpful. I'll leave it there.
Thank you. Jamie Howcliffe-Johnson to be followed by John Mason.
Thanks very much. Good morning to the panel. Just before I come to my kind of main line of questioning, I just wanted to ask, a number of my colleagues have asked about the impact on leaving the EU on our economy and the impact that's going to have. And I think the kind of general answer seemed to be that we can see some impact, but it's quite hard to tell because of COVID and other aspects. But of course, one of the focuses of the Scottish Government at the moment is leaving another referendum to leave the United Kingdom. And we have all the potential questions around borders and debt levels and currency that haven't been answered, and we don't know in terms of we have estimates in terms of deficit but not a kind of agreed. So I was just wondering, and perhaps I could go to Professor Chadha first on that and then to Emma, how that kind of constitutional or political uncertainty might impact, because we might find ourselves certainly the intention of the Scottish Government would be out of the UK, but also out of the EU for a number of years. And I'm just wondering how that might impact on kind of business confidence and economic recovery.
Well, thank you very much. I think what to be clear, I think I was trying to say that the Brexit process, where we had uncertainty about the future economic relations, as well as the political imbroglio that resulted, seems to us to have led to a drag on business investment, led to some atrophy in political decision making that affected businesses, and as well as dragged on FDI. It also subsequently seems to have had an effect on our labour employment levels in this country, as well as shortages across many industries, as well as some reduction in the ability of businesses to plan in the medium to long run. All of that, we think, has reduced GDP output as measured by some 4 to 6% in the very long run. So that's the kind of estimate of where we sit at. Now, if we entered into further political uncertainty of whatever form, whether it was Brexit or other referenda, that of course would then lead businesses and other people to introduce further clouds of uncertainty into their planning horizons, which in the short run would almost certainly detract from the kind of things I've just talked about, business investment and the deployment of labour. And then that, of course, then becomes an issue for whatever political configuration we have in the future to address. The biggest tragedy, it seems to me, the last 6 years is that rather than the political frameworks solving uncertainty, reducing it, providing answers, we've had a world in which the political firmament has been adding to it and making things worse often rather than better. And what we'd want from any settlement in the future is that there is sensible policy making on an ongoing basis that helps businesses and individuals and households deal with uncertainty. The classic example of which I'm referring to are the events around the mini budget in September and October, where the uncertainty there led to some devastating economic spillovers from which we are recovering but haven't yet fully recovered. So I guess I'm saying that more uncertainty would be a problem, but if we ended up with the right set of policies, they could be offset substantively.
Thanks very much. If I come to Emma Congreve as well.
Of course, thank you. That's a really interesting question. We do find that, as I say, there can be big differences of opinion, both on the impact of Brexit and on the impact of a potential new referendum in Scotland. Our institute hasn't run specific analysis on the impact of Brexit recently, but I will very much agree with what the OBR and the National Institute have said, in that there is impacts that are there in their forecasts, and I do, as I said, it's very hard to see a scenario where Brexit can't have had that impact. In terms of an independence referendum on a move potentially to an independent Scotland, so following through as the fact that if Brexit is having an impact, then yes, you would think that an independent Scotland may run into similar issues, but of course it will depend on what settlement is reached in that scenario. So we could have had a Brexit which was much more softer, is terminology used often, that didn't put up these barriers that we're grappling with as an economy, and that might have meant that there wasn't this disruption to the economy in the same way. But the Brexit agreement that we've gone with at the moment has led to those impacts. So the key issue will be, well, what would the settlement be in independent Scotland? And very obviously difficult to know that, because it would be a negotiation. So obviously potential for disruption there, in the same way that we've seen with Brexit. And as you say, REST UK is obviously a very strong trading partner, which would also, any impacts of Brexit potentially, but it all depends on what that negotiated settlement is. The thing that's unavoidable is the uncertainty it brings, and businesses and the economy doesn't like uncertainty. But that's inevitable. We have a constitutional debate. We're going to have uncertainty for a long while, yes, I imagine.
Okay, thanks so much. And Susan, I don't know if you want to add anything to that.
I think Emma just summed it up really well there by saying, yeah, it depends. I think we've got uncertainty now for a whole range of reasons. And I think one of the things that I really noticed when speaking to people about just on the timeframes on which decisions were being made. So a really good example is, when we were talking about European funding, that was made on a much longer term timeframe than the kind of funding's coming out of the UK government now. We're down to sort of 3-year timeframes. Business and society needs longer term timeframes. So it's how do we work and give certainty over a longer period of time?
Okay, thanks very much. Susan, if I can come and stay with you actually. I suppose the kind of issue's been raised about what would you want to see the Scottish Government do in terms of their competencies, looking forward to help deal with current economic uncertainty, cost of living crisis and the like. I'm not going to say what would you want John Swinney to ask to do tomorrow, but what can you kind of outline some of the areas that you think that the Scottish Government, the competency of the Scottish Parliament, can act to deal with, as I say, some of the impact of the challenges that we face over the next few years?
Thanks. So if you look at the most urgent need that's coming through in our work on the Understanding Scotland survey, so the Understanding Scotland survey tracks over time how people feel about the economy, their perceptions and their spending habits. So it's giving us a really good threshold. And roughly in that, there are about a third of people really struggling. So losing sleep over financial stress in their life, and that affects their ability and to participate in the labour market, whether or not they're in work or not there at the moment. I think there's other things that we can look at. We've got a big problem with changing demographics and an ageing population, but the focus has to be on how do we stop more people becoming absolutely destitute, with the word that Professor Chatter used before. The Scottish Child Payment is going some way to help the parents, that are, was it 35% in the last survey that were losing sleep? And I think it's going to be harder as more people enter the challenging financial circumstances, and that figure's likely to rise. I think there is a bit I'd like to come back on from the earlier discussion on the change in the labour market. If that's all right, I'll squeeze it in. The voluntary decision of people in that late 50s, early 60s bracket to retire, if we could get some of those back into the labour market, that would be really good. And the analysis done by the Institute of Fiscal Studies is really interesting, because lots of presumptions have been made about people are inactivity rates are rising because of ill health. And their analysis challenges that. And I think some of that is when you look at the high vacancy rates and the Skills Development Scotland analysis of, if your organisation is running with a high vacancy rate, the pressure on the rest of the employees rises. And we shouldn't underestimate that might be a driving factor in why some people are leaving. They're just deciding, actually, working is too stressful, I'm going to draw down on my pension. But if you think of pensions needing to last for up to 30 years, maybe even longer, that might be a short-term gain, but a long-term pain. So I think we need to think about all those long-term things as well as the short-term when we're looking forward on the economy.
Okay, thank you. If I can come to Emma on that as well, and if there's any specifics that you have particularly around that, how we get some people who are out of work, out of the kind of labour market back into it, that would be very helpful.
Of course. So it's interesting, it is interesting, the ill health issue, but I'll come back to that in terms of Scottish competences in a second. But yeah, in terms of the voluntary leaving the labour market, the late 50s, early 60s, I do hear what Susan's saying in terms of the long run financial support. But it's obviously, if it's a voluntary decision and people feel that they have the financial ability to do that, quite difficult really to think about what effective government policy could be to lure them back in, other than potentially it's very much the nature of the job market and their decisions over their personal decisions over what they do there. But I mean, the area I think that the government could and should be really thinking about is, I kind of explained it before, it's just getting some of the basics right. So the basics in terms of what Susan talked about, in terms of actually, ensuring that the destitution is not the kind of scenario we're looking at for many people. There are a lot of the powers around social security that are reserved to Westminster, but the Scottish Government does have powers to top up benefits, to create new benefits. It could be doing that, although it's potentially lead time in terms of getting those systems set up and ready to deliver. But the other area is very much around health and social care, I'd say, in terms of the understanding the linkages between those sectors and the issues they're facing and the economy, and actually ensuring that there is the money in the system to keep those systems functioning well. And it's not just about one thing. You know, we'd hear a lot about issues with, you know, bed blocking, for example, as being the key thing that the Scottish Government's trying to do everything it can to limit the issue of. But it's not just that, obviously. It's symptomatic of huge issues around unpaid care, around the well-being of workers in the health and social care system. Of course, public sector pay comes into that. So there are a huge range of issues that require quite, you know, quite deep thought and understanding about how those pressures, and in the very short term anyway, over this winter, how those pressures can be eased so that we don't have this issue with people, you know, not being able to work or work well because they are caught up with delays in the health and social care system.
Okay, thanks very much. And lastly, Professor Chad, if you've got anything to add to that, and your thoughts would be very helpful.
Well, thank you very much. I think Susan and Emma have been through all the things that I would have wanted to say, with the extent to which destitution at the very bottom is a concern, and the extent to which it is concentrated in certain postcodes or regions of Scotland. We're also aware of the extent to which the cost of living crisis is also affecting those at the very bottom of the income distribution. There is a concern we haven't expressed today about just the dwindling level of savings that households have. We have a world in which, following the COVID crisis, actually household savings have increased, but they're very much concentrated with households at the top of the income distribution. That means that households towards the bottom, some 11 million across the country, are going to find in the next 18 months or so that they don't have any savings left. In a world in which they're continuing to have to pay higher energy and food bills, they don't have any savings to help them offset those costs. They will need support through universal credit or the other forms of support we've just been described, and it's important that we have measure on those in Scotland at a disaggregated level, that at the level of the devolved nation, Scotland doesn't look that worse off compared to many of the other regions in the UK, but I guess as it is everywhere else in the country, there's a lot of heterogeneity once you drill down to a more local level, and it's important that we're aware of that. One thing I think that was missed by a number of policymakers earlier this year is that if you haven't got any savings, you cannot ride shocks. You hit your budget constraint and there's nothing more you can do. Those of us more fortunate with savings can draw into them when shocks come along. If there are significant numbers of households without savings, they immediately either cannot pay their bills, have to go back to their provider for some form of credit agreement, potentially go to their landlord or their mortgage provider for forbearance. That's not always forthcoming. May not be supported by legal frameworks, or have to go to other forms of credit supply, which are incredibly problematic, as you would understand. So I think there has to be work done there on getting the measure of this problem at a refined scale, if we could, so we could address it in real time. We can't wait a year for households who have no savings. It has to be done as quickly as possible. I think I can add to your point.
Thank you very much. Thank you. I'll take a brief supplementary from Gordon MacDonald and then John Mason.
It was a question for Susan. You talked about the number of people that were retiring because changes in the market, labour market. I was just wondering what the impact of UK government changes to pension regulations had on that. You're on mute.
It's fine, Susan. Broadcasting will sort it out. Go ahead.
I was just thinking I hadn't unmuted, but it wasn't me, so that's OK. The Institute of Fiscal Studies has got some really good work on this that I can share with the committee afterwards. And they've also done a podcast on the people leaving work. And I think, for me, the question that Emma picked up on earlier, in a way, it's not a government policy thing. It's almost down to the businesses that Gordon was talking about. How do businesses make themselves attractive when they've got gaps in their own workforce that older people might want to come back and work for them? And some of that might be, you know, changes to flexible working if people are balancing
grandparent care with wanting to also work, but that still being part of the labour market, there is a skilled proportion there that could come back to work if they wanted to. But I think we're storing up problems for the future. Professor Chatter mentioned the rundown in savings. People are also stopping paying into their pensions because they're worried about putting food on the table and heating their houses today. And that is just, if we're already got way below the rate of what's classed, as the Resolution Foundation call it, the living pension. We need to think about how do we avoid a problem in 10 or 20 years' time because of the cost of living crisis now. And I think that really does worry me about what's coming down the line for people that are on the breadline now.
Thank you, Susan. John Mason.
Thanks very much, Convener, and thanks for the opportunity to be here today in place of Colin Beattie. That's a privilege. Energy has clearly been mentioned a few times, and I just wanted to spend a little bit more time on that, because I think the point's been made by yourselves and others that the energy prices, which is largely out with the UK's control, have gas and so on, have gone up dramatically. That has fueled inflation and that is damaging the economy. So I just wonder, and I think some of the public wonder, you know, is that are we doing the energy the best way we can be doing it? Because as I understand it, Scotland produces five times as much gas as we actually use. And we also are producing all this renewable electricity, which I think is meant to be cheaper, certainly in the long run, and yet people are not seeing that. So, I mean, is this just something inevitable that we have to accept, or could we be doing energy differently to support the economy better? Maybe I could start with Susan Murray.
I do recognise none of the panellists are here as experts on energy, but broader terms, if you wish to answer the question, please go ahead.
Thanks, Claire. Yeah, I'm not an expert in energy. I am aware, though, of the discussion about over the years, how Ofgem regulates the market has been subject to much discussion, and it feels like the energy crisis has brought that into sharp focus. And I think the fact that we're still looking at prices fixed on gas rates when there is so much production now done by renewables is something that needs to be fixed, you know, reasonably quickly. And I think the other thing for Scotland, I've heard many stories over the years of people wanting to do micro renewable schemes and not able to get grid connection. And I think that has held back adoption, where we could actually have even more generation. But I don't want to comment more than that because I'm not an expert on energy policy.
Yes, my apologies. I realised that I wasn't speaking to energy experts. Neither am I, of course. Do either of the other two want to come in on that, Professor Chadha?
I think just briefly, I'd certainly say I'm not an energy expert, but a world in which non-renewable energy sources are going up in price provides an important incentive for furthering our move to renewables, as well as thinking about energy security. Our ability to have inventories of energy in this country have been undermined in the last couple of decades. And I think there is a sense in which we need to think very carefully about how we provide security of energy supply. The direct question of the increase in energy prices is also an interesting question, because we would want the higher prices to lead to people being more careful in their use of energy and realizing it's a scarce resource. But that said, that's a very damaging set of prices for people at the bottom of the income distribution. So I think we've been arguing for some time for a very different approach than just fixing the price per unit, which in principle is more helpful to those who use more energy, which tend to be those people at the top of the income distribution rather than those at the bottom. I should say, of course, many people at the bottom of the distribution do use a lot of energy and may be living in older housing stock that requires insulation or support for making it more energy efficient in its usage. That, of course, could also have been undertaken with direct interventions to help poorest families. I think we generally regret that the energy price guarantee, as outlined, wasn't addressing those issues as well, that would have been less damaging to the fiscal position, but also provided more support to poorer households. So again, this issue has raised a number of questions that good government policy ought to be addressing. And I think we're in the area of thinking about those now as a result.
OK, and if I could come then to Emma Congreve, but what Professor Chad has just touched on is the kind of support then, and that's where I wanted to go to next, is what kind of support should either the UK or the Scottish Government potentially be giving, and I suppose particularly businesses, because the kind of support we've seen so far, I mean, I'm getting £400, I'm ridiculously well paid, you know, why am I getting £400? Just seems crazy, and there's other people really struggling. So the bigger picture and also the smaller local picture?
Yes, thanks. So I think what you've touched on is important, because there are many reasons why you would want to better target support for energy prices, and yet people are receiving income to help with energy costs who might not need it, and other people are needing a lot more. Obviously, when it comes to the feasibility of doing support systems, a universal approach can often be easier. I wouldn't necessarily say cheaper, because given the sums we're thinking about, I wouldn't necessarily say that. But there are lots of factors that policymakers need to weigh against each other when deciding what the right way to get support out to people, so that it does get to those who need it, but the consequence of that might be that it also goes to some people who don't. But that might be the most efficient way of doing support. But obviously, from what we've heard from UK government most recently, is that they are looking at a different approach from April that isn't quite so universal. They've kind of rowed back on saying that that's the support that's in the system at the moment, and the energy price cap will continue beyond April. Again, we're waiting to see what that will be. There is actually some very interesting interaction with the inflation measure, depending on what type of support package the government puts out there. The way the system at the moment doesn't count towards inflation, but a more targeted support might actually count towards the inflation measure, and that has implications for inflation expectations and all of that kind of thing. So there's unintended consequences potentially there as well. So there's not a simple answer, I'm afraid. There's a lot of different factors that we're trying to weigh up to work out what the most efficient and effective support system will be. But we need to know that what that system is going to be fairly soon, as I've previously said, in order to get the right people, enable people to plan for beyond April.
I mean, if I could just push you just a little bit further on that, especially as far as businesses are concerned, because Professor Chadha made the point that on the one hand, we actually want people to become more efficient, and that would be true of businesses as well, not use energy that they don't need to be using. And yet some clearly do need to use a lot of energy for a whole variety of reasons. So, I mean, have you any thoughts about how we could target businesses and try and get that balance right?
Other than being able to analyse and take an evidence-based approach to where support is most required in the system, I think that's what we'd be expecting to be happening, rather than it necessarily just to be a blanket support. But I don't think I can comment too more specifically on that, I'm afraid.
Apologies. My apologies for pushing you on that one. Susan Murray, would you like to come back in on any of this about where support should be kind of targeted on energy prices and so on?
No, I think it's not an area we've done specific work on. I would use, when you said though about you not needing your energy grant, can I use the opportunity to mention the Give 400 campaign? Because I don't know if anyone's aware of that, but there's a movement in Scotland for people that don't need their energy support package to donate it to charitable causes. And we have seen in the Understanding Scotland survey that charities are likely to lose 40% of their donations this year. So, yeah, please do donate it if you don't need it. And I think Emma's points on targeting, and go back to Gordon's initial question on businesses, it could be... how the decisions and choices that are made around who is supported and who isn't in terms of businesses might make the difference between survival or not. And we will see, businesses closing as a result of energy costs, I think.
Yeah, well, thank you for that answer, and thank you for your suggestion that I give my £400 away. My colleagues are all pointing at me. Thanks, convener.
We are now beyond the time that we'd estimated. If the witnesses are happy to continue for 10 minutes or so, I will bring in Michelle Thompson. And I understand that Professor Chadha may refer back to the questions from John Mason, but I'll hand over to Michelle. And you can add in, I think you wanted to come in, Professor Chadha, you can add it to the response to Michelle if you wish.
Well, perhaps, I mean, because I am aware of time, I appreciate you giving up your time. I'll just direct my kind of final question to Professor Chadha. When we were talking earlier about uncertainty, we've talked about how you disaggregate data and so on. Emma Congreve's touched on that. But actually, we do have the past arguably is a good predictor of the future. And given that this session is an overview of the current macroeconomic climate, I thought it was worth pointing out that, you know, some of the stats around the UK since 1999, only four of the 12 small advanced economies had a GDP per capita higher than the UK. And by 2019, it was 11 out of 12 of them. And even since the economic crisis, if the UK had matched the economic growth rates of other large economies, the UK economy had been 4.4% larger. If it had matched small advanced economies, it would have been 7.7% larger. So I suppose that gives us considerable certainty because we can look at the past. So my question to you is, given that those economic stats, to what extent can we be certain of continued decline if the past is a good predictor to the future? And to what extent are we really a hipster or an otherwise economy?
Thank you very much. The relative decline of the UK economy has been in train for well over 100 years. It was the largest economy of the world in the late part of the 19th century. So we're used to that relative decline, but you're right also to point out that it's been more marked in this century than we otherwise would have wanted. We've fallen further behind what economists call the productivity frontier, which you can imagine is a set of countries that are moving very quickly ahead with productivity improvements. And we put so much weight on productivity because it tells you how much return you get for every hour that you work. And it is a very good way of summarizing well-being. If you're getting more of a return for every hour that you're working, you can have more leisure or more consumption as a result of that. But that secular trend, we think, is very much associated with when I say very much so, but associated with a large number of factors, as you would expect, the whole of the system. An economy that was arguably too centered on the financial circulation of capital out of London and the South East, inappropriately prepared in terms of human capital and other skills in the economy for a 21st century economy, infrastructure absences across wide parts of the country, a lack of internationally competitive firms sited outside of London, the South East and Scotland, providing local pools of demand that would bring in people with high levels of human capital and associated basis, raise wages of people further down the skill level in those areas as well. There's a whole range of things that have required attention from successive governments that haven't been addressed that I think are the main reason for that rather larger fall in relative decline than we might have anticipated a quarter of a century ago. The result of all that view and analysis is that it cannot be addressed very quickly, certainly not in a statement made tomorrow or in the next year or two. There needs to be a persistent need by a revamping of our institutions and the objectives of our policymakers to drive us into a better space. It's not going to be easy. It's going to require a consistent approach that we haven't had for quite some time. And that's why I'm chairing the Productivity Commission, to try to understand how we can bring about policies to which political leaders can not only commit to now, but future political leaders will commit to as well. Classic problem we have in the UK is the horizon of politicians in Westminster is determined by the next election, which is some 2 years away. But the problems that we've outlined are ones that have developed over a quarter of a century or more. So we need much longer horizons in planning and thinking. And I think that's where we desperately need to go as a country. The move to more powers for devolved nations is part of the answer, it seems to me, but we haven't arrived at a full answer to deal with the problems that we face.
Well, thank you. I mean, there's multiple further questions, but I'll leave them just now in the interest of time. Yeah. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I would like to thank all three witnesses. It wasn't the cheeriest note to end on, but it has been a very productive session. We do appreciate the time you've given us this morning, and it will help inform our work in the coming weeks. I'll now move the meeting into private session.
Thank you.